La razón por la que nos venimos a Estados Unidos fue porque pues era mamá soltera, dos hijas pequeñas, y yo sentía la necesidad de que ellas tuvieran una mejor vida y una mejor educación que la que yo les estaba dando. En México, conseguir un trabajo pues no es fácil. Para empezar, después de 30 años uno ya no puede calificar para un trabajo y lo dejan a uno relegado. Y lo menos que puede uno hacer, ir a trabajar a limpiar casas. Mal pagado, bien agotador, pero es lo único que uno puede conseguir. Y no alcanza mucho porque pues el dinero está muy devaluado. El salario es prácticamente nada comparado aquí. Y pues cuando uno está acá y puede trabajar legalmente, uno mira la diferencia que hay en nuestros países con el trabajar aquí. Sentí la necesidad porque también mi familia estaba tratando de ayudarme para llegar aquí. Entonces decidimos venirnos, cruzar ilegalmente, arriesgamos nuestras vidas, pero gracias a Dios pudimos llegar acá.
So I was really young. I was 7 and my sister was 14, and we traveled across the border using the term that they say in Mexico is coyote or coyote, which is a person that is paid to illegally bring people over across the border. It was quite an adventure to me, but of course my mom and my sister were much more terrified. I didn't really know what was happening, but I knew that I just had to pay attention and follow instructions, and that's what I did.
Después de que llegamos, mis hijas pudieron ingresar a la escuela, a la mayor a la middle school y Katerina a la elementary school.
Once in the U.S., my mom had to work several jobs, and we were living with several other families in a house of the relative that helped us get here. So we were really cramped. We all slept in one bed in one tiny room, and my mom worked two jobs at a time just to pay the people that helped us back and to somehow start saving up to afford her own place. And we moved into an apartment to Nashville, and that's when I started school. So I started school in like the second semester of second grade, which was really tough for me, and I'd never gone to school in Mexico or any other place. I was very behind, so that was really tough for me as a student to try to catch up, and I've always kind of felt a little bit behind. And once I graduated, I realized what our documentation status and was and how that affected me. For some reason or another, I wasn't really aware of what DACA was and how that worked or what were the logistics with that, so I never got one. It wasn't until I started applying for colleges and talked to my counselor that I realized that I couldn't afford college because I would have to pay twice as much, and I just couldn't afford that. So I had to take 2 years off between high school and college, one to get my DACA and another year to work to save enough money to afford college.
Pero antes de eso fuimos víctimas de violencia y calificamos para una visa U que se tardó mucho tiempo en llegar. Estuve inactiva durante mucho tiempo.
I no longer have DACA because in the midst of my high school and all of my life, there was a really hard thing that happened in my family's life, where I was a victim of a crime involving a church. And so it was very difficult. After we filed a police report and went to talk to counselors, et cetera, the police department actually was the one that let me know that I could apply for a U visa, or a U visa, which is a visa for victims of a crime. The way that that visa is different from the DACA is that that visa opens a gateway to citizenship and residency, which DACA doesn't offer. So I applied for that forever ago, but I still had DACA and had to worry about paying for that every 2 years, worrying if I wasn't going to get it or not, because there were cases where people just didn't get it just because they did it, not because they actually did anything.
Y el tiempo, pues, que estuve esperando por la visa, pues sí fue un poco frustrante, un poco desesperante, pero creo que valió la pena la espera. Bueno sería que aceleraran más los procesos, porque según se mira en las noticias, hay demasiada gente esperando por sus visas para poder trabajar.
Last summer, I got a phone call from my attorney that let me know that my mom and I, because I applied but I like added her into my application because she also qualified, that let us know that we received the visa, which was really life-changing, but there's always a but. We didn't actually have the visa itself. There's a wait list because every year they can only give out like 30,000 or so visas, and it's not really your fault if you don't get it, if you just get it but there aren't enough to give away. So what they do is they do deferred action for the visa, which means that you have it but you don't actually have the physical thing, if that makes a little bit of sense. So in about, attorney said, in about 2 or so more years we'll get the actual visa, and then in another, I think, 4 years we can apply for residency, and in another 7 years we can apply for citizenship. So it's a really, really long road to citizenship, but it's possible, which I think is a blessing.
Al fin llegó y pues recientemente estoy trabajando ya con mis documentos y me siento bien porque pues es una ayuda que el gobierno da a las personas que hemos sufrido un crimen. Y también pues yo miro este país como una esperanza para quien pueda llegar, ¿verdad? Siempre y cuando no arriesgue su vida, porque yo sé que en otros países también hay mucha necesidad, hay mucha violencia, hay mucha inseguridad para seguir o quedarse a vivir en esos países es muy difícil.
Immigration is a topic that is so confusing even for people that are immigrants, that it's hard to sometimes empathize with those that are struggling with their immigration status and those that are immigrating. And I think one good thing that we can do is to listen to the stories and to practice empathy in an active way and not label people as immigrants and therefore unwanted, or immigrants and therefore, I don't know, criminals. So I think just listen to the individual and not what the masses are saying about certain individuals.
Salir adelante, sacar adelante a nuestros hijos, nuestra familia, es riesgoso, sí, pero yo pienso que usando la frase común que hay, que sí se puede, si luchas, sí se puede, si perseveras, sí se puede. Lo he visto en mi hija, que ella nunca se ha rendido. Yo sé que a veces ha sido duro para ella. Mi hija mayor está casada, tiene un baby que tiene 1 mes y medio. Y Katherine pues está a punto de graduarse de la universidad, que para mí es algo realmente, siento que mi deseo y lo que yo he soñado para ella está cumplido, gracias a Dios.
So, yo sé que el ejemplo que me has dado ha sido la fundación de todas las decisiones que he hecho, de saber esforzarme pero a la vez cuidarme, de ser amable pero a la vez darme a respetar, y el ejemplo me lo has dado tú de todo lo que hago, y de ayudarme a centrar mi vida en Dios y a no olvidarme de dónde soy ni de lo que soy capaz.
Quiero que sepa que estoy muy orgullosa de ella, porque sé que se ha esforzado muchísimo. Hemos pasado muy poco tiempo juntos, estos 4 años, pero yo me he aguantado las lágrimas, me he aguantado el tiempo, y sé que vienen tiempos mejores tanto para ella como para nosotros como familia, porque estamos realmente agradecidos con Dios y orgullosos con ella, porque se ha esforzado muchísimo y es una gran hija. Y sé que es una gran amiga también.